continue to blaze the trail in the promotion of entrepreneurial and vocational skills and pragmatic linkages with the world of commerce and industry. Contributions to the industrialization efforts of Nigeria through the outturn of innovative and creative entrepreneurs who are involved in the production of much needed goods and services, as well as the introduction into the Nigerian workforce job creators who will serve as catalysts for the rejuvenation of the economy. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the choice of the topic for this convocation lecture and the guest speaker is not a coincidence. The major index for growth and development across the globe is a sustainable entrepreneurial practice for the enhancement of poverty eradication anchored on a sound education background. Similarly, the choice of Professor Fola Lasisi as the guest speaker is premised on his dogged belief in the promotion of entrepreneurial skills as a requisite tool for the industrial growth and technological emancipation of our country. Technical and vocational education, along with entrepreneurial skills development and proper mentoring, will help to propel our youths for economic liberation and self-actualization in our march towards being relevant industrially and technologically on its dogged hyper-competitive global landscape. More importantly, it would help to enhance the actualization of our country, Nigeria, as an emerging economy. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Yaba College of Technology is privileged to use the opportunity of this occasion to future contribute to preferring practical solutions to some of those things that have posed a challenge to the economic and technological development of the country. That solution is centered around entrepreneurship, mentorship, as well as technical and vocational education towards empowerment of the critical mass of the nation. This is our clear call for constant interaction between the town and gown to pragmatically encourage our youth to embrace entrepreneurship and vocational education as a necessary signpost to illuminate the dark spots of our economy and industrial endeavors as a nation. I wish you all a rewarding experience at this convocation lecture. Thank you all and God bless you.
Thank you, dear Rector. I now have the honor to call on the technocrat, entrepreneur, and president, Manufacturers Association of Nigeria, Dr. Frank Jacobs, for his speech.
Thank you very much. Director, Dr. Mrs. Kudi Adekwa, our amiable rector, principal officers here present, management staff and students of Yaba College of Technology, our guest speaker, Engineer Professor LASISI. Gentlemen of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I am highly delighted to be here today. And I'm happy that Yaba College of Technology and the organizers of this convocation lecture found me worthy to chair the occasion. For that, I thank you all very much. The topic of this convocation lecture, Sustainable Development, Entrepreneurship and Mentorship Roles in Youth Empowerment, is not only apt, but it is fitting. Especially at this time, when Nigeria is faced with the challenges of low income from crude oil being our only export product, the major export products. Today, the mood of Nigeria is to move away from the so-called monoproduct economy to diversification of our economy. And in doing this, the youth has a major role to play. Industrialization is very important, is key to the diversification project. I believe that in choosing entrepreneurship and mentorship as a subject of discourse today, whoever crafted that topic had Nigeria at the back of his mind and has put a lot of thought into it. And I commend them for doing that. I'm not going to preempt the guest speaker because I'm very confident he's going to do justice to that topic. But it is important for us to know that the only way this country can move forward is if we can empower our youth and point the way to them on how to become self-reliant. Not always looking for white-collar job. What is more is you that attend polytechnics. You make up the middle-level manpower, which we don't lack. So if the quality of the education you come out with is what it should be, at the end of the day, you'll be the main players in our industrial field. I see Nigeria as being technologically and industrially virgin. That means that we have a lot of opportunities which unfortunately are yet untapped. The country is endowed with a lot of human and material resources, the kind that many countries will envy us, but these resources are hardly exploited. Maybe because we haven't been able to marry our knowledge with those resources. But the moment we're able to marry the knowledge we have, the exposure we have, with the abundant resources in this country, industrialization that is sustainable will be born. At present, most of the industries we have in Nigeria are packaging and assembling industries. And today, because of the challenges we have in the economy, there is a paradigm shift. And I am glad that the current government is supporting this paradigm shift away from assembling and packaging to actual industrial processes, manufacturing processes, where we can utilize the available resources to produce the goods that the country needs. I always say, don't always say, I want to look for a white-collar job, because it's not there. But be an employer. All of you have what it takes to be employers. And it's not too difficult. all it takes is the will and come up with the idea. In the past, people used to say it's money that determines business. It's not true. Today, idea, a bankable idea is what determines the success of any business. If you put a lot of thought into the problems that face this country, and you try to marry those problems with the knowledge that you have, you'll find solution. And in finding solution, you can become an industrialist. So I urge all of you to think about employing people and not being employed. And you have all it takes to do that. Yaba College of Technology has the right standard to give you that opportunity. So I'd like to thank you once more for coming. And I'd like to thank the organizers of this lecture for deeming me fit to chair the occasion. I know we are going to, at the end of the day, walk out here happy and more enlightened from what we are going to learn from the guest speaker, Professor LASISI. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, sir. It is possible, if Dr. Frank could be an entrepreneur, you could be an entrepreneur just as I can. Ladies and gentlemen, on the program now, the next person is an erudite scholar, a grammarian, an Englisher, a well-traveled scholar, Dean School of Liberal Studies, and the college orator. You get to know that when you begin to speak. That is Mr. Fred Fatuashi. He will read the citation of the guest speaker.
Madam Rector, permit me to stand on the protocol fully established. In presenting to you the guest lecturer, in the present Ijebu Northeast local government area of Ogun State, Nigeria, is a small town of Odose Lualaro, situated on the fringes of Ijebu Ode. This quiet village was visited by a giant baby in an infant appearance in the early afternoon of the fifth day to the end of the second month in the 17th year preceding the independence of Nigeria. This baby of destiny was born to the family of Pa and Madam LASISI, and a few days afterwards, he was named Abdurasak Afolabi. The little Rasaki was a beautiful child to behold as he grew in strength and knowledge and health. And when the time came for his primary or elementary education, he lapped up the waters in the manner of a thirsty greyhound on a hot afternoon. Finishing elementary education and not being fully satisfied, he proceeded to the Yaba Technical Institute, Yaba, Lagos, where he raced through his secondary education and in no time finished excellently with the enviable, very scarce class of distinction
in the year 1962. This was the beginning of the academic journey of the young LASISI. The same LASISI has come back here today, Ma, to showcase just a bit of the learning he has acquired, which got kick-started by his attendance of the great Yaba Technical Institute of yesteryears. He stands before this audience today as an icon of erudition, a quintessence of knowledge, and a paragon of intellectualism. This is the Afolabi Omokolawale of Yabatek and the Rasaki Omokayode of the great Yabatek. He is an alumnus we are very proud of, and indeed our alumnus plenipotentiary. The young FOLA was awarded the African Scholarship Program of American Universities in July 1963 to the University of Washington, Seattle, to study civil engineering. He graduated excellently in June 1966, spending only 3 years. He was awarded a master's degree in civil engineering structures of the same university on fellowship. That was in 1967. He later proceeded to the University of Wisconsin-Madison, being sponsored by the University of Ife, now Obafemi Awolowo University, and the USAID in 1972, where he acquired the doctorate degree in agricultural engineering in 1974. That was at the age of 31. He gained the recognition of a professional engineer in Wisconsin, USA in 1972 and became a registered engineer in Nigeria with Koren in 1974. The young Afolabi in his mid-20s worked as a design structural engineer with Marshall and Parker in Seattle, Washington, and eventually returned to Nigeria in October 1969 to join the University of Ife as lecturer 2. As a scholar given to tenacity and doggedness, he rose through the ranks and became a professor in the month of October 1984. At IFE, he was the acting head of Department of Agricultural Engineering, 1977 to 1981. He also served in many committees and chaired several of them, especially the ones on physical development of the campus of OAU. He was also a member of the committee that developed the agricultural and civil engineering programs for the university. He was chairman UNEVOC, that is the University of Ife Consultancy Services, between 1989 and 1992. Professor FOLA LASISI, as better known by his teeming students, colleagues, and friends all over the world, has published extensively in national and international journals, covering studies on use of local materials in construction, structural analysis, and engineering designs. He was chairman of the Ogun State Agricultural Development Corporation between 1988 and 1991. He was a member of council of the Federal Polytechnic, Ilaro, between 1990 and 1993. And currently is a council member of the Nigerian Institute of Management. He has held this position since 2006. Professor LASISI is the chairman, Academy of Corporate Management of the Nigerian Institute of Management, Chartered. Professor LASISI is preferably referred to in other quarters as a pioneer vice chancellor. This is not unconnected with the fact that he is indeed the pioneer vice chancellor of the University of Uyo in Akwa Ibom State, where he served two full terms. And again, he is the pioneer vice chancellor of the private university, Crescent University Abeokuta, where he served from 2005 to 2007. He was chairman, Committee of Vice Chancellors of Nigerian Universities, the position he held between 1996 and 1997. Professor LASISI is indeed a pioneer in many enviable things. Professor LASISI, whom I call on this occasion a multiple professor, being a professor of civil engineering, a professor of mechanical engineering, a professor of agricultural engineering, he is also an entrepreneur of international recognition. He teaches entrepreneurial studies, business development. He has interest in business activities, primarily as a professional engineer, and also has investment outlets in several places to prove the Ijebu man in him. He is a senior consultant to the Emplan Group, is the chairman to Pilot Finance Limited, is the director to Pilot Securities Limited, and also is the chairman of Urban Trends Limited, to mention but a few. Professor LASISI has been a committee member in the establishment of some private universities in Nigeria, including Crescent University Abeokuta, Fountain University Oshobo, the Caleb University Imota, the proposed University of Ofa, the proposed Ibrahim Inolaji University of Ikire, the proposed University of Warri Delta State, the proposed City Model University Port Harcourt. He is, of a truth, the grand consultant in university affairs. Engineer Professor Afolabi Abdulrasaq LASISI is a fellow of the Nigerian Society of Engineers, fellow of the American Society of Civil Engineers, fellow of the Nigerian Institution of Agricultural Engineers, fellow of the Nigerian Academy of Engineering, and fellow of the Nigerian Institute of Management. The guest lecturer we are lucky to have today has also been honored at home for helping the young in community, especially in the area of acquiring qualitative education. Professor LASISI earned the title Obong Ibereden of Uyo in 1995. He also bagged the title of Ntanta of Oron in 1979 in the same Akwa Ibom stage. He received the highly coveted Merit Award by the Awujale of Ijebuland in 1999 for excellence in education. Professor LASISI is the Baba Shelu of Odo Shelu Alaro, his hometown in Ijebu Northeast local government. Madam Rector, just a couple of weeks ago, precisely on the 27th of August this year, Professor LASISI was again honored with the Chris Abebe Award in recognition of his significant services to the progress of humanity in the Nigerian Institute of Management. Engineer Professor Abdulrasaq Afolabi LASISI is happily married and blessed with children. Oko Monica O, Oko Joanne, Oya Dakungbera Nle Ise Ti Ya, Ko Wa Bomi Toru Oko Si Wa Lenu. Wani genge oya wa ba wa lu bembe imo iwo se bi won omo layo re le baba yin lo megun wo po re mo ijebu omo alare o Omo agbonrin jagun Omo abere oje sowo eni ni jebu omo ajagbadura omo afidipo temole afidipo temole komo lote o gbojinijini komo lote o gbojolojolo ijebu omo arojojoye omo afegba sawo loke sagun omo bi un se ni oyoyo yo oyoyo mawule yo mo nitori ntin se ni ole ipani omo adurun made omo aladiye ogogo moga omo adiye gorokun opo lele ohun da fi durun mokun padiye je ijo to ba wujebu awun ni e wini wini ijo so ba si tun wujebu awun ni e ni wini wini bo ba wujebu afe ni otoku a fi sodun alage mo omo olada nodoru eyin lomo banta omo araso nla poruku loju de oba ijebu omo alare o ijebu ti nawo dola tele tele koyinbo to kowode oyinbo tun kowode tan owo ijebu tun po si kekere ijebu owo ni pa ijebu owo ni okunrin ijebu owo ni Professor Ijebu na to nko owo ni Ewe so gbogbo eyan ma lare awa mila bolo de sode awa mila bolo de sode o de ure o ti ya o o de omo ya o professor LASISI o
thank you thank you thank you Director of Yaba College of Technology, Dr. Mrs. Margaret Kudi Ladipo,
the chairman of the occasion, Dr. Frank Jacobs, the deputy rector, academic deputy rector, administration, the registrar, acting bursar, chief librarian, and other principal officers.
Working. This thing is weak. Weak.
Oh,
the battery is weak.
Okay.
Then you cannot use.
But you can change. You change?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
No problem.
All deans of schools, all heads of departments and units, all academic and administrative staff, I want to specially recognize the Aluminium Association members and president. Can they be upstanding? Aluminium Association of Yaba. I want to recognize them because that is my root. Please be seated. The student of Yaba the Great. Up Yaba! Up Yaba! Up Yaba! Yaba Bosa! 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 The press and ladies and gentlemen, don't forget I was an administrator for many years. So the students must be recognized. Because without the students, we don't have any job. Without the students, we don't have any job. Without the students, administrators, academics don't have any job. Clap for yourself. The lecture today is a special one for me because I'm coming back home. I first came here 57 years ago, 1958. And this institution changed my life. So I want, because of this, to thank the rector and the management for giving me this special honor. I want to also thank Dr. Mrs. S.F. Oye Oketuji. Please be upstanding. The reason I'm recognizing her is because of something I hold very dearly. When I was studying chemistry in this school, we had a teacher who was teaching us chemistry and physics, Mr. Davis. And Mr. Davis used to write equations for us. And these equations, we will always see time. For those who know enough about equations, you write F bracket XYZ bracket and put T as subunit. So if you do it, it means that the most important factor in addition to the other variables is time. I had an appointment with this lady on Friday about 10 days ago. I had just come back from Abuja. And I told her we'll meet at 10. She was in my office by 9 o'clock. Please clap for her. Anybody that holds time as precious has won my mind. So I want the first thing that the students should know is to keep time. If you have to go to lecture, you must be there on time. If you have to go to different things, you go on time. I will also give you a personal experience. When I became a vice chancellor, I found that members of Senate were not coming on time. So after 2 Senate meetings, I decided 10 minutes after the time we were to start, any senator that was not there, we closed the door. He has not come. And if you miss meetings twice, we will remove you as the acting head. If you are a professor, we can remove your allowance for being a senator because money is attached to it. So time is of excess in anything we do. It is time to die. It is time to be born. It is time to die. In Excelsior chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. Time for everything is so important. So I salute you, madam. We have selected, can you put on the PowerPoint for? Okay. It is important to note, if you go to page 3, the lecture topic came up because of our interactions. And the issue of the topic was discussed, and we agreed that sustainable development should be the core. So the title is Sustainable Development, Entrepreneurship and Mentorship Roles in Youth Empowerment. Our final call is on youth environment. So if you look here, if you go to the next, determines what we do. Education has long been known to be the bedrock of development. If you are thinking of development and you don't look at education, you are wasting your time. So does sustainable development education, and somebody called Perura made this statement, and I thought it's something we should refer to. Sebastian Pinera is the author. It may be good to Google this and you will get something. Stable economy. To have a stable economy, to have a stable democracy, and a good modern government is not enough. We have to build new pillars of development which are rooted in education, science and technology, innovation, entrepreneurship, and more. I will be talking briefly about the last part, more equality. The problem in our is that there is a big gap between the people on top and the people at the bottom. If you look at Nigeria today, we have many billionaires, when we don't have many thousandaires. If you go to the village, I visit the village regularly. I come from the village. My wife, who is an American, keeps telling me that the village never came out of me. I have no regret. Because God knows why he asked that I should be born there. So I go to the village. When my parents died, my father died 30 years ago, my mother 20 years ago, he thought there is no reason I should go back to the village. I said, you're sorry. I've been given another elevation. Because we are all going to die and we must have replacements. So my parents were lucky to have some replacements. Clap for my parents, please. So equality is important. If you give 5,000 to somebody in the village, you can see how excited they get. 5,000 naira can change the life of people, while people easily cut away 5 billion naira. And where are they going to go? In the end, they are going to go to 6 feet. For the taller ones today, maybe they put them in 7 feet. But all is going to be in the soil. That is where we are all going to land. If we remind ourselves of this, then we will do something better. So if you, my main lecture submission that relate to sustainable development, and we are looking at 3 facts. We are looking at the environment, we are looking at the economy. In many societies, it is the economy they look at. That is the arrow point of America. The arrow point of capitalism is economy. And that is not what it should be. The world was not created for money. The world was created for man. So you must also, when you created the man, God also give us the environment, the things to survive on. He put on the land. If you look at the origin of man, he gave us vegetables, he gave us animals to control. No matter how big the animal is, no matter how strong, man was put in charge. So if you look at the economy, and you don't look at the man, and you don't look at the environment, it will fail. So the main issue of sustainable development is these three arrowheads. Looking at man, who is managing the environment, and ultimately managing the economy. If we focus only on the economy, we will miss the boat. May God not allow us to miss the boat. Next slide, please. So we have illustrations that basically what we are doing is trying to put people together so that they can work by understanding what is sustainable environment. In brief, what I've said is the core. You all have the paper. So I'm not going to keep you here. In your time, read the paper. So if you go back and read, we are talking of those three things and how we manage the three things so that we can live long. Because our time is short, we will go. If we don't produce, we don't maintain and do proper management of the environment, our children will live in squalor. So our children will have nothing to inherit. Our children will only be focusing on money, and money you have enough, if that is your focus. No, you have enough money. That is how God has made it. So if we go on. If we go to the stage, I'll just go to my paper. If you go to section three, go to the beginning of three, because we are looking at how it affects us and other things, so I produce the details so that it becomes a reference point. Under three, we are looking at entrepreneurship and the mentorship antecedents. Mentorship antecedents. What are the basis? The idea is that people must create jobs. It's not all of us who will create jobs. And the way to do it, I'm happy we have Dr. Jacobs here. That is part of the function of MAN, Manufacturers Association of Nigeria, to promote industrialization and build people who are going to develop businesses, and these businesses will employ people. All over the world, it's been known that SMEs, small businesses, not necessarily the large ones, that employ most people. SMEs, small, medium enterprises. Pardon me, I'm getting old. If you are over 70 and you say you are not old, where are the ones, they used to say 20, don't play together for 20 years. And now you probably have to say 50 children don't play together for 50 years. Because when they wrote those, people were not living as long. Contrary to information that we'll have, if you go to look at history, because before medical sciences took well, people were dying young. It's not just in developing countries. Even in Europe, everywhere, it's true they are living longer today, but they didn't used to look so. If you look into the holy books, how the years were measured was different. Some people were supposed to have lived 200 years, 300 years. Please, where was, you know, I talked about time before. What is the measure of the years of that time? Before you set the years. So if they were living 200 years, why are we finding it difficult to live 70 years today? Those are questions to ask. but you can get that in the book. So the idea of mentorship is brought in because if you are seniors who are already established, must nurture them. So we have people who are natural mentors. We can also develop people who develop to be good mentors. If you look at our institutions, there are rangers, they want to be the only one that get promotion, the only ones that move ahead. They are dreaming. God has another equation for them. If they don't do the correct thing, God will correct them. And that is faith. So the better thing then, so there will be people to do good, people to remember your name, people to create development. And that is how societies move on. That is how societies continue to develop. If we look at history of China, China has been on as a nation for more than 5,000 years. But they had leaders that were just thinking of themselves. They were just messing up, going around and wearing coats of gold. Go and look. You will see leaders, emperors, different ones, wearing coat of gold, living in houses made of gold. Where did they end? In the soil. And they held the country ransom. They even sold Hong Kong for tea. Hong Kong was sold to Britain for tea. Tea that you drink. That was the origin. That is how Britain took over. Then Mao Zedong came. So God decided on the time, and Mao came on and change the place. May God give us the leader that will change Nigeria positively. So, entrepreneurship must come from that view that we want young people to learn from older ones how to begin to think positively about becoming job creators rather than people looking for job. The transition is not easy. We are still looking for job for our children. We are still running around, even though we are telling them to create jobs. But if the good leadership is there, it will occur. I will get to some of these facts in which our government has done some work, but we need to build on them because government recognizes that entrepreneurship is important. You have an entrepreneurship center in this college, and I know it's functioning well, madam. So I'm in touch. So, and I've read some references by some of the staff working on youth entrepreneurship here. So we can understand entrepreneurship by looking at who are entrepreneurs. The people who are there are good thinkers, people who are always thinking, what can I do that is unique? And I will give you an experience I ran into many years ago. In 1976, I was thinking that I promised my in-laws in the US that I brought my wife to Nigeria, she must live here, but we will come to US every year. Signs began to show up that we might not afford it. So I was in a committee that was supervising a project by Julius Berger in Ife. And we are producing cabs made of concrete. My main research was of some concrete or alternatives to concrete. So I said, these cabs, I went to Professor Aboyade that I noticed Julius Berger was selling the cabs to the university at 100 naira each. And I'd gone into my lab and produced this in, and I saw that I could produce it for 20 naira. So I went to Aboyade, who was ready to listen, and I said, I will supply 5,000 for 40 naira. He said, come and eat dinner in my house. What brought you that idea? That's what I'm talking about, innovative thinking and other things. So I went to his house with my wife in the evening, and we sat down. He said, from 100 to 40, how can I get this to our council to approve? Why don't you agree to sell it to us? at 70 if they test that they have the same quality. I said, they should go and test. So they tested. They said ours were even better than the one supplied by Julius Bada. So they accepted that I should supply 10,000 at 70 naira each. You know what that meant? 70,000 naira when my monthly salary was under 2,000. So I mobilized people and got it in supplied, and I built my first house in Lagos. Clap for Entrepreneurship. So you begin to look at what you can do that will generate. And it's not all of them that will succeed. I will give you another experience that we set up a unit in the consultancy unit to make sure that the roofs of some of our buildings made of concrete will not leak. Because most of the roofs were made of concrete, and concrete has pores. So when water falls on it, the tar that is put on it will break up because of change in temperature, and water will migrate, and the roofs will leak. So we said we had some solution. We will get possible another type of tar that will not break up. It didn't succeed. I just want to say, but we didn't give up. We then decided, how do we save it? So we made a proposal to the university that we should use long span to cover all those roofs. If you go to Ife today, you will see that all the concrete roofs that we had before are now covered with long span and no leakage. So you must have a failure to get a correct solution. So if you run for failure, then you will not make success. So it's important. So the issue of entrepreneurship is not that difficult to look at. So if we move on, that factors in mentoring success. Successful mentoring requires the following key features: screening of prospective mentors, matching mentors and youth on relevant criteria, pre-match and ongoing training and frequency of contact. Most of this is in the paper. There's nothing I'm talking about except some references. So by contrast, mentoring of being not successful, when any of the following conditions apply: social distance and mismatch. If people are not willing to mentor, you cannot force them. They must be interested. So you need a situation where the mentors and the mentees work together. If you go on, there is a definition for youth, 14 to 25. This keeps changing. I was reading something recently when people were debating some people getting married at 18 or 17. And people forget that even in our society, people were getting married at 10. I have a colleague of mine who is a professor, whose mother gave birth to him legitimately when she was 11. A professor, 11, in Nigeria. So it is not good that you marry that early, but don't say that it is something that was just invented. Go and Google. You will find in Europe, Henry IV took his wife of 9 years old. That is why Anglican Church broke away from the Catholic Church. Isn't it because of divorcing his wife, and he took another wife who was a young lady that he broke off and said, I can't be controlled from Rome. I'm going to take my wife and become the head of my church. That is what happened in Britain. So age and time is always coming up. But that is not saying it's not correct, because the lady must be trained. The lady in modern time must also be a leader. That is what we are covering by youth. The lady, if the husband abandons her, should she not be able to survive? In modern times, husbands are abandoning their wives because they are looking for excitement that would not last. So those are realities of society. So I have daughters. I'm very happy to have them, and I'm making sure they are going to be graduates before they get married. So clap for my daughters. One of them is here. The one that is here is already doing master's degree, and she's not married yet. So, and she's 24 or 25. So the issue is to understand what is going on and take a decision how you are going to do. That is the people factor. People, environment, and economy. The three things we started with. So it's better to look at that. So if we move on, we want to look at chapter 5. If you can get the beginning of 5. Education, challenges in entrepreneurship and mentorship. The idea of the word challenge, very recent. We are always afraid to mention that we have problems. So the society decided about almost 2 decades ago that call your problems challenges. Whether you call it anything you call it, they are still problems. And you must face them. If you don't recognize the reality, then you are joking. Changing words here and there is another matter. So we have a brief discussion on challenges in entrepreneurship and mentorship. Pre-entrepreneurs, we are looking at the formative stage, developmental stage, and the startup stage. If we go to the next, we will find that what you need is tactical skills for growth. Even when to talk about tactical, it can also be technical. Access to working capital. That is what government is trying to solve recently. The Bank of Industries is linking up with National Youth Service Corps and some consultants, and they voted 2 billion naira that they get 1,000 people on youth corps, they give them special tests, and they give them between 500,000 and 1 million each to start up their own business when they finish their youth year. I commend this initiative, but it hasn't gone far enough. You are giving 1 or 2 billion, and you are taking 1,000, and in 1 year, you are sending 200,000 people on youth corps. So what have you scratched? So what is wrong with starting with 20 billion when some individuals through their pen can cut away from 5 billion and disappear? Look at our pension money. I'm a pensioner. Somebody disappeared with how many million? Pension money, 7 billion. And they still roaming the Abuja all around. And you are giving 1 billion to National Youth Service, 200,000 people. You cannot be serious. So the thing is that seriousness must be brought in and do the correct thing, then you will have impact. So the other issue is people who are trying to become entrepreneurs. How do you encourage them? We have listed how you can do this. Implications of policy is also discussed. And we are looking that in Nigeria, some of the problems are related to the following. The first is political instability, presence of inflation, inadequacy of information, capital, is insecurity, lack of stable power system. I would say that the three last ones is what we will talk about. Inflation will always happen. Politics will always be in place. But capital is what we have just discussed. Insecurity, government has to solve. Lack of power supply is being recognized, and government must work hard to see that we have stable power supply. Dr. Jacobs knows this better than me. For those of us who also grew up in Lagos, if you go to Ilupeju Industrial Estate, they have become event centers. If they are not event centers, they have become churches. And that is not really it. Churches are important too. Mosques and churches, faith, very important. But it's not industries that you should convert to them. Let them go and build their facilities. The industries should strive and produce things that the ordinary people will need. And this must be promoted. Event centers, you go and do Owambe on Saturdays, or starting from Thursdays. Is that what is going to help this country? Dancing around and eating when people are eating from the dump grounds. So the thing is to promote things that will benefit the ordinary people. And you can do this by, in fact, starting with stable power. So we have information here on some of the details, and you can read them. So I've gone to 6.5. UNDP decided to have a program. There is a UNDP, United Nations Development Program, for youth empowerment. And they look at strategy. They are listed. One, increased economic empowerment. That is 6.5 in the paper. Enhanced youth civil engagement. And then strengthened youth engagement in resilient building. So if you can attack those things, then you will be able to move the country forward, and the youth will have a share in the future, because whether we like it or not, they are the owner of the future. So it's good to work very hard to get the youth to work hard. Towards the end of this section, I decided to look at some quotations on empowerment. One of them, and I quote, "Incredible changes happen in your life when you decide to take control of your life, and especially things that you have power over, instead of control, craving for control over things you don't." I will also give you a personal experience. We are talking of power. In many homes, they don't see light. There is a slight improvement recently. But in the average home, you may not see light for 24 hours, sometimes for 36 hours. And when it doesn't come, and some people come to me and say, "This power shortage, what am I going to do about it?" I said, "Do you have power to do anything? You make noise and see if government can do it. If not, if we worry too much about it, you will die and we will bury you. So don't, things you have no control over, don't give yourself a day. But you can make noise. If the government listens, they will make changes. If they don't, you better adjust yourself so you can live long. So it's very important. The second part, no matter what happened yesterday, it is insignificant when compared to what lies ahead. Don't be spending your time looking back. See what you can do today and tomorrow. If you spend too much time looking back, then you'll be in trouble. And there is a Yoruba adage that when a young fellow falls down, the young fellow is only looking to the front because he has the future. The old man looks in the back. Why did he fall down? So you look briefly, see why you fall down, so you can pretend, you prepare not to fall down. But not that you worry about it. You want, the old man is planning for the young man is only running. And he's not going to get anywhere if he didn't know why he fell down. So planning for the future is most important. Number three, the only thing that stands between a person and what they want in life is the will to try and the faith to believe it is possible. That is the voice. Number four, the moment you become friends with your inner self, are we having people who don't like themselves? I've been people, when you go to the mirror in the morning, say, "Rasaki, I like you. I like it, what I see. This is what God did for me. I like myself. And I shave, I clean up. I say, Lasisi, you are great. If you do this regularly, you are going to be great. Like yourself. Like yourself. If you don't like yourself, you can't like anybody." That is the spirit of that quotation. Passion, passion. What do you do with yourself? If you have passion, you develop it. If you wake up in all our faith, people need time to think. The ordinary people spend time crying. They spend time worrying. They don't spend time saying, the situation I'm in, what can I do to get out of it without killing myself? So you need to spend time, wake up in the night. The Christians have, what do you call this thing you do in the night? The Muslims have, it's a tajud. We call it tajud in the night. It's best between 2 a.m. and 4 a.m. You wake up, you have 2 rakats. Then you pray, you think, you'll be amazed. As a Muslim, it has helped me. And my Christian friends say when they go, even on their own, Pastor Martins is here. He's always giving people advice. Pastor Femi Martins, how are you? I didn't see you hiding in the back. Stand up. The other stood up before. Pastor Martins is our president. Pastor Martins, clap for him. So you do things that you can do. The way forward. 6-7. Children and young people's participation and empowerment need to go beyond platform and participation. Number 2, promoting mass information. I wanted to comment on it before, that there is so much information. Unless you are very lazy today, if you don't have facilities in your home, you can go to IT centers and get information. Once you begin to look, something will gel that you can use. It's important we take advantage of the modernity that we have. So look for information, you will be able to move forward. It's very important. So empowering young women, I've mentioned it before, that young women are important. The women in society form 52% of the population. Have you looked at the statistics? There are more women than men, no? And because of that, there are other problems. I'm not a sociologist, so let's leave that area. So the women must be empowered. I've said it indirectly. I spend extra time to make sure that my girls do better in school, because they are the ones prone to problems. They mature very early. You know, I have a friend's son who is 45 and said he's not ready to marry yet. I just call him an idiot. Because when is he going to get married? Because he said, I'm not ready yet. I've not built a house. I don't have 2 cars. Did your father have 2 cars before he got married? All those things came in later. Go and get married. He's been running away from me. So, but the girl, if the girl doesn't get married before 35, she's headed for trouble. So she has to be prepared, and if possible, I'm telling my girls, marry before you are 30. If not, you will quarrel with your daddy. So it's very important that to them. So we have special responsibility to take care of this 52% of our population. Based on the above observations, there are things we need to look at to help the young people. The people who can think must use this ability and help us to develop. That is what institutions like this do. They think ahead of us. They put things out that will help the society. And we hope that the society buys it. I'm going to show later in a few minutes why we are failing here. Because our politicians are not listening to the institutions. They are not funding the institutions. So, and if you don't listen to the thinkers, you are going to fail. So you will be also led by idiots. The thinkers must also join the bandwagon. That's what is called the bandwagon effect. If the thinkers don't join politics, you will be led by idiots. And that will be a problem for you. So they must also participate. But it's not all of us who can participate. So the builders and the sustainers, those are the 3 groups of people. Concluding remarks, page section 7. The main thrust of this lecture has been a contribution to the well-established need for sustainable development to take firm root in our national planning and implementation. The challenge is for the relative national government to take the leadership role in looking again at existing programs, adjust them, restructure them, so that entrepreneurship and mentorship become part of the program and they take control. Going on, funding is at the center of some of our failures. When funding for education gets to around 20%, I think UNICEF and UNESCO, they recommend 22 to 26%. So even if we get to 20%, our institutions will be better funded, we will maintain the facilities, the laboratories will be okay, the students will go out do attachments. I was mentioning in a lecture recently in the Lawrence Ogbomosho, Ladoke Akintola University, about 2 months ago. I gave a lecture on mentorship, and we found that in engineering, lecturers are not going out again to follow the students who are an attachment. I got to know this country. I drove to Sokoto before. I drove to Maiduguri. I drove to Kano in my car in the 70s. I drove to Port Harcourt. Some of you may not know that up to 76, there is no road to Port Harcourt. Calabar. I drove one day to Oran in 1975. And the ferry had just left, so I had to sleep there. The road between Ikorekpene, Uyo, and Calabar didn't exist. So you go to Oran, very bad road, and you take a ferry. The ferry will take 20 cars, and then you go across to Calabar. You can see Calabar across in 1975. So I went to see students in Calabar in 75. I went to Maiduguri, I went to Jos. Now when you tell a lecturer, they are only looking at their paper. Papers alone won't help you. You will get promoted, but you won't get a good name. Get a good name. The students you go to supervise are the ones who are going to recognize you in future. So clap for those who do their job properly. The introduction of mentoring into the workings within the public service and critically in our educational institutions will produce profound effects on sustainability. The private sector is well known for this. I'm referring to Dr. Jacobs again. The private sector is always mentoring. They are mentoring successors. They are looking at good people. Onosode was my pro-chancellor for 4 years. Gamaliel Onosode told me that Bumi Oni just came in as a graduate from Ife. And he saw in him some brilliance. And he said, in 10 years, this fellow will be MD of Cadbury. And that is what happened. He started mentoring him. He put it ahead of those who are not so brilliant. And in private, if they put somebody above you, who is not, and you are not brilliant, you resign and leave if you are not satisfied. So they push for the best. And that's how Bumi became MD of Cadbury. The private industry is doing this regularly. Why shouldn't we do it in our total system? It is important because the criteria is sometimes not very encouraging. It is important to look at a few things in my concluding remarks. So first is leadership and mentorship. I have a quotation here. Number two, college experience. I said I'm very lucky that people mentored me. I was telling the director earlier today how I got to my university in 1963. The December holiday, I went to Professor Richards, Professor of Structural Engineering at University of Washington, Seattle, and said, I have 3 weeks. Is there anything you do that can be useful to me? He said, what you go, you're on fellowship. I said, but I'll just be going around during the holiday doing nothing. He said, I have a toddler. Where a big gates lives now was a wilderness in renting. The area is called renting near Seattle. That is where Microsoft is. So they were opening the place up. My friend's son is working there. Chief Elihu, when did you come in? Stand up. Stand up. He's a fellow of this college. Stand up, Chief Elihu. Clap for him. A son is in Seattle. It's in Microsoft. So the tunnel, I was sitting there. And I was being given allowance. On May 11, 1964, I bought my first car. First year in the finished the first year. I bought my first car more than 50 years ago. Clap for my professor. So you have a way of helping young people. And it is this way that made successful people. That's number five. I've seen that phenomenally successful people believe they can learn something from everybody. Because you are successful doesn't mean you know it all. I've talked of lone rangers. Lone rangers are not good leaders. It is when you surround yourself and you trust them. Those who abuse the trust, you deal with them by discipline. If you trust people, you surround your people with doing well, just like I referred to Mrs. Oketunji earlier, that she's a good manager and supporting director. Madam, thank you again. So, Richard Branson has given us examples of how to build young people, build others who do well. So I think my assignment is be done. I want to thank the director again. I want to thank the students for listening to me. Many times when you try to talk, the students don't listen. I want you to clap for yourself again. And I'm grateful that I'm able to do this. Thank you and God bless. Thank you.
A louder round of applause to our professor, entrepreneur, administrator. Okay, so for our professor as he's relaxing, we want to present another alumnus by name Johnson, who recently waxed a record to mark what he calls Yaba Tech Anthem. Johnson, are you around? Please come here. So, they say in Yoruba, alumni man she in call, is it not? The alumni are doing wonderments. That's the interpretation. Johnson?
Thank you, sir. Yaba Tech. When I say Yaba Tech, you say the best. Yaba Tech. Yaba Tech. Yaba Tech. Yaba Tech. Yaba Tech. Now this is dedicated to our heroes and heroines. Those who have they've contributed to the sources of this school. Names like Professor LASISI, names like Omotola Jalade, Olusegun Obasanjo, Pastor Martins, so many names, and I'm using this honor to appreciate my wonderful rector, Dr. Mrs. Kudirat Margaret Ladipo. No, stop. I want all of us to do the song together. Now it goes thus, the chorus. We rep Yaba Tech first, still the best. We rep Yaba Tech first
and the
greatest. We rep Yaba Tech first and the best. We rep Yaba Tech first and the greatest.
We rep Yaba Tech first and the best. We rep Yaba Tech first and the greatest.
DJ,
let it go.
Roll it.
We rep Yaba Tech first and best. Greatest Nigeria student. Greatest of the 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 greatest Nigeria student. Now so, DJ.
DJ, roll it.
We rep Yaba Tech. Why yes? I'm back in the ayayaya.
It's not the place, I don't swallow
no. We don't even make noise, they already know.
Like you do, you would,
they are worse. Anywhere we go, they know we got flow.
I'm a tall guy, they rap
Yaba Tech.
We be like group,
rap Yaba Tech. Yaba Tech. All rap Yaba Tech, no. Yaba Tech, jeez, we're so cool. Where we go, in the room.
Inside Yaba Tech, no time for real rumble like two.
And you, we are winning us. Yaba Tech, you don't know.
We rap Yaba Tech,
and the best.
We
rap Yaba Tech, and the greatest.
That's an emblem.
You don't see some bombs as the anthem. Yaba Tech, you are.
We always represent like military in warfront. We don't relent them. We are on the cloud. No way down. We are
coming down.
See team on the warrior drum up there. You can see us in the crowd. Let the blueprints.
What blueprints?
I kill to the bridge. That's the best letter. No place that we ain't treading on.
Academically, yes, we've been champion. How the push?
Like big boys and big girls in the game.
I'll push you. Say what? What do you think you're telling me? Let me have a test. That's you do real me. So, back aside, back aside.
New lights, bridges, lights. Come here.
It's the routine that you're saying to me.
Anywhere we go, we got standing
ovation. Over the best, over the first.
I'm on the contention.
As what? I'm blue, I'm going to get attention.
All
I
want to
do is represent that. Yes! And the best.
Doctor.
could you admire the latest for?
Thank you, ma'am.
Respect to the past and present.
Respect to ever dynamic. What did it? A louder round of applause to the alumni, to Johnson and his group. And don't forget that Johnson read accountancy in Yaba Tech, but today he is a musician. So that is, I'm quite sure Mr. Akumaka will be very happy because he is the doyen of entrepreneurship in Yaba Tech, and we will be happy that people are crisscrossing disciplines. Once again, along the line we have in our midst the director consort, Chief Emeka, Emeka Okoro, well seated there, ladies and gentlemen. And I have the honor now and privilege to call on the chairman for his closing remarks, Dr. Frank Jacobs, please. Chairman for the closing remark, Dr. Frank Jacobs.
Thank you very much. Are you listening? Well, you have all listened to the lecture this afternoon. You must have learned one or two things from that lecture. The lecturer talked about mentorship and entrepreneurship in youth empowerment. I think the aspect of mentorship challenged those of us that are already operating in the manufacturing sector. And I wish to use this opportunity to tell you that we are currently mentoring the youths. We have a man, the lecturer talked about mentorship and entrepreneurship in youth empowerment. I think the aspect of mentorship challenged. May I have your attention, please? Hello?
Good.
Hello? Very good. As I was saying, man has what we call Entrepreneurial Development Center. And there we use our members who have proven their mental in manufacturing to mentor these young people. We have programs that last about 3 months. This is open to graduates who want to be manufacturers but don't know how to go about it. You go through this course for a period of 3 months and you are empowered on how best to start your own business. Earlier when I was speaking, I said that you don't look for white-collar job. You become the employer. And there are ways you can become the employer. So if you're interested in this when you graduate, please call us a MAN, Manufacturers Association of Nigeria. And we will learn one of a few things that will help you become a manufacturer. Again, I'd like to welcome all of you and thank you for being here all this while. And thank the organizers for bringing me here today. I really enjoyed the lecture and I enjoyed myself. Thank you very much and God bless you.
Thank you, Chairman. Before the vote of thanks, I want to make this announcement that the people on the high table,
chief lecturers and specially invited guests should kindly come over to the catering restaurant after this program. But for the rest of us, our refreshment is within this auditorium. Yes. 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 Please, let us be careful how we comport ourselves. This event is being watched all over the world. For your information, the program is being streamed live, just as the convocation tomorrow is going to be streamed live. So you are being watched all over the world. It's a warning to everyone. And let us lessen our noise. Don't let us make a noise at all. As I said, this program is being watched worldwide. I now have the honor to call on the registrar, Ms. B.C. Amakapabo, for the vote of thanks. The registrar, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. On behalf of the rector, the college management, staff and students, I'd like to express our profound gratitude to the chairman of this occasion, Dr. Frank Jacobs. He was billed to attend another function when he was invited, but he had to alter his itinerary to be able to be here today. Thank you very much, sir. We are very grateful. To our guest lecturer, he's a triple professor, an alumnus of this institution, and a great friend of the college. We want to thank you for this valuable lecture you have delivered here today. I know that everyone seated here had learned something to go home with. We say a big thank you to you, sir. To our graduates, you are the reason why everybody is here today, and I want to believe that you have learned something from this lecture that will guide your decision with respect to the career you want to undertake. We have been told that you should not look for white collar jobs. Try to use your knowledge to do things that will make you an employer rather than an employee. We want to thank you for your presence here, and it's our sincere hope that you carry on the torch of Yaba College of Technology wherever you find yourself. Thank you very much for coming. To our Alumni Association, the president and members of the Alumni Association, want to thank you for always being around us all the time, for your support and friendship. We want to thank you for your presence here today. Welcome. The deans of school and directors of academic units want to thank you for your presence here today. I'd like to remind you, tomorrow is the convocation ceremony and everybody should fully participate. The heads of academic departments and service units want to thank you for your presence here today and for participating in this lecture. To our orator, you are indeed an orator. Your citation today of our professor was beautiful and everybody was happy. It was very well rendered. Thank you for a perfect job done. Members of the press, we want to thank you for your support, and it's our hope that all the events of this convocation ceremony will be fully covered in your reporting. The technical crew, we thank you for your activities here today. The members of the security services, we want to thank you for giving us the confidence to sit here without any fears. Thank you for your services. And for the chairman and members of the ceremonies committee, we want to thank you for providing this beautiful environment, for your choice of guest lecturer, for your choice of chairman, and for ensuring that this hall is full. We want to thank you for all that you have done. Our distinguished guests and all other invitees, we want to thank you for coming, and please be here again tomorrow to celebrate with our graduates. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you everyone for coming, and God bless.
Thank you, Madam Registrar. Please, if you are the owner of this car, a Mercedes-Benz C200 with number EP889DN, kindly go and remove it because it's obstructing other users. Owner of Mercedes-Benz C200 with number plate EP889DN, kindly remove it, it's obstructing others. Ladies and gentlemen, we're coming close to the ending of this program as I invite our dear brother HOD Accounting, Mr. Latif Agbetunde, to say the closing prayer. Closing prayer, Mr. Agbetunde.
We thank you, Lord, for being with us from the session of the program up to this present moment. We thank you as the fountain of knowledge. We are every source of knowledge comes from. We thank you for the knowledge you have given our professor. We thank you for the knowledge he has disseminated to us today. For the fact that we acknowledge that the ultimate source of knowledge is from you, please continue to shower that blessing on us. Everything we have got here today, everything we have learned from the professor today, may every one of them be blessed such that it will materialize in the life of our students and the life of we, the lecturers. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifuna wa salamu alal mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Sallu ala nabiyyi karim.
Thank you, Mr. Agbetunde. Please, the recession will be in reverse order. The high table will move out first. Don't forget that honor begets honor. And before then, we are going to render the national anthem standing. Kindly stand all. Kindly stand. Kindly stand for the national anthem. National anthem, ladies and gentlemen. There will be group photograph outside, and don't forget, let the people on the high table move out first before you start trooping out. Thank you.